Thank you for inviting me to Pécs. I've been enjoying the presentations, discussions yesterday. I'm looking at migration, which has really become a dynamic field of study, especially recently in the study of political science, international relations, in other social science areas too. And so also migration is, in a way, one of the few direct ways in which people, including the disadvantaged, the marginalized groups, are doing their own international relations directly, including by walking the deserts, crossing the oceans. In a way, it is interesting. I do focus on Ethiopia and Eritrea, due to, of course, close affinity. This is Ethiopian, also Eritrean affairs, especially large number of hundreds of thousands of people, especially young people, are leaving the countries. These departures, fleeing, have become quite significant since the changes, these political changes in particular in Ethiopia, 1991, also the time when Eritrea separated from Ethiopia. And its recognition as an independent state. EPLF, control of Eritrea, still. TPLF, EPRDF in Ethiopia until 2018, 4 years ago, dramatic political events in Ethiopia. Removed TPLF, EPRDF. From the picture, although the culture of power is more or less the same. And in fact, in 1990s, Isaias Afwerki, Melas Zenawi, Kagame, remember, where they were praised as new generations of African leaders. In Ethiopia, there were attempts at democratization and economic liberalization. In Eritrea, no, not much of fanfare with democratization or liberalization. Why? Building a new state, the imperative of building a new state, firm control of state power continued to prevail. Well, the result domestically, the characteristic or the characterization of the relationship between the governments and the societies, different categories of people in Ethiopia and Eritrea, antagonism. Antagonism prevails, antagonistic state-society relations. The interests of those in power, it diverges from the interests of the various categories of the population. Even when, of course, the objectives, the peace, development, and the democracy objectives of the governments are presented in the name of the people, for the people, it fundamentally diverges. And those policies of development, peace and democracy, actually end up in suppressing in fragmenting, in instilling fear, in disuniting, dividing the people, in particular in Ethiopia. That is the map of the region from the internet. A particular theoretical perspective of out-migration or migration, I've been trying to articulate, looking at the practices of international relations, looking at the dealings of extra-regional actors and actors in the region, state and non-state actors. State and non-state actors from outside the region, state and non-state actors in the region. The relations is one of clientelism, which I am now calling, trying to develop as a theoretical perspective of international relations in the Horn of Africa as transnational clientelism. You know, transnationalism catching up with clientelism. Once clientelism, once considered an aberration, you know, a doom of politics in Africa or African politics. Now we see when this clientelism is transposed onto the transnational space. Well, there was patron-client relations, patron-client relationship during the Cold War also, largely involving, you know, ideologically aligned forces, Western capitalist, Eastern blocs, you know, looking for clients and status in the region, Zayed Barre, Somalia, Mengistu, Ethiopia, Nimeri of Sudan also, looking for global patrons. What makes this new clientelism, transnational clientelism, is not only states, state actors, IGOs, international government organizations, NGOs, international and local, individuals have become visible in these relations. And looking at the management, the term itself tells a lot. I really enjoyed the presentations, critical presentations yesterday on migration, NGOs, humanitarianism. Those are really rare. You know, the beauty of academic engagement is, you know, only those of us who are privileged to be part of such discussions can enjoy, can hear those critical voices. Ordinary people in Ethiopia, in the Horn of Africa, can't hear those critical voices about migration. So my definition of transnational clientelism is there, condition in which powerful states and non-state actors from outside the region persuade, co-opt, annex, provide resources and incentives to state and non-state groups in Horn of Africa region in the forms of or in exchange of, it is highly transactional, by the way. Exchange of services, roles in regional security, strategies, anti-terrorism operations, fighting piracy, you know, of course, access to natural resources, fishing, land, energy sources, trade and investment are what the client states, the client actors from the region can offer. State and non-state actors in the region, including Ethiopia and Eritrea, Eritrean actors have been benefiting from the transnational, transactional dealings with the patrons from North America, Europe, the Middle East, and Asia. This is targeted. You know, it is mutually beneficial. I mean, to those that are involved, you know, at the expense of the population, the vast majority of population, marginalizing the population and yet benefiting from that. People do migrate in search for what? Not only material benefits, not only escaping poverty, but also, you know, in search for dignity, in search for freedom. When survival is at stake, the means of survival, the economic means of survival is not there. The methodology I used is analysis of available information, mainly from the web, reports of IGOs, IOM, refugee agencies, NGOs, like Regional Mixed Migration Secretariat, and so on. Typical features of this literature, these reports, you know, the domestication of the terms like migration routes, the study of migration routes, tracing the routes people are following or using. The actors, obviously, actors dealing with or involved in the management of out-migration from the region are from Europe, including EU, Middle East states in particular, Saudi Arabia becoming prominent, Eastern and Southern African governments are involved in responding to out-migration from countries of the Horn of Africa, Ethiopian and Eritreans, contribute to the bulk of migrants. EU responses, we know, since the Khartoum process, in doing that, you know, we saw instances where, you know, Al-Bashir government, the government in Eritrea, in Ethiopia, of course, the Ethiopian government has been, governments have been viewed as partners in the region. Pressures were easing, you know, 2015, 16, 17, 18, and on, you know, the pressures easing, pressures against the governments in the region were easing because now they were caught in this clientelist dealing of managing migration, deploying state security forces, controlling the borders, new migration policies, laws in Ethiopia, for example, giving, ID cards for migrants, for refugees, out of camp policies, and so on, local FM radios, you know, creating awareness about the danger of human trafficking, and so the money came from the EU in particular. Responses from Saudi Arabia and the UK as of late. You know, Saudi Arabia, massive expulsion of Ethiopians, hundreds of thousands of Ethiopians, is still ongoing. And the recent UK's reaction, you know, processing, refugee status in Rwanda is quite dramatic. The example of the high watermark of, you know, clientelism at its best. Nothing would have described that. Southern African responses, detentions of Ethiopians, Eritreans in hundreds, but also releasing them quick. The Southern African response to out-migration or migration management is less clientelistic. Not much money is involved. Yeah, government is police detain Ethiopians and Eritreans, release them after months. International development actors are really caught in the situation. You know, UNHCR, you know, coaching, you know, Ethiopian government practices, how many IDs Ethiopian government is giving, the out-of-camp policies, and so on and so forth. Officials of IOM, for example, publicly, when they came to Addis Ababa University, using terms like illegal migration. Imagine an IOM official using a term, illegal migration, while from academic conceptual point of view, there is no illegal migration. There is no illegal migration. So in general, a context of intense transnational involvement in the Horn of Africa, not actually addressing, not significantly addressing. Yesterday we talked about resilience and so on and so forth. Really, there is no, observable positive relationship between these workers and the plight of migrants. While the involvement, the model of involvement is intense in the region. National local government institutions criminalizing people. In Ethiopia, for example, police officers, government officials are boldly using the term illegal migration and forcing people, young people working to migrate, to go underground. So these are the situation. So in general, my conclusion is that it is more of a paradigm of transnational clientelism. Of different colors, bearing on policies of management of migration at a global level, regionally also attempts to put similar schemes at place. National government is, in fact, in exchange of funding and so on and so forth, are quite pressed. And of course, many dimensions to the clientelist dealings, looking at Djibouti, number of military camps of powerful extra-regional actors camps in Djibouti, including those from across the Red Sea. Thank you very much. Thank you.